assuming this is in Norway.
I'm
Anne Widdecombe,
and I'm in Norway.
Yep.
I've come to one of the most unusual...
Oh, I'm in Norway! Oh no! I'm in Norway. I'm in a luxurious prison.
Pre-watched? Come on, dude. Of course, it's not a pre-watch. I know that Norway has, like, fire prisons.
Prisons in the world.
This is a spa. It's a holiday resort.
With a very relaxed approach to relationships.
We get visits 2 times a week.
They can have sex.
Yeah.
Why is she mad? Why is she upset about that? Also, what the f-? Is there going to be TOS in this?
Why do you want to get me on the floor?
And every home comfort you can think of.
Actually, it's better than the outside world.
Woo!
There's even a waiting list to get in.
You bargained with the police for where you were going to go to prison.
Flush apartments for rapists and murderers. And even some escapes.
How many do you lose that way?
It all sounds very dubious to me.
I love this. I love the concept of, like, having, like, an older British Tory woman seeing, like, you know, progressive society and, like, humane treatment of caged humans. Like, I don't know what this is. I don't know who this person is. I just assumed, I suspect anyone with a haircut that dresses like that is a Tory. Okay. But I love this as a concept. Like, I want her to go to, like a cooperatively owned business and shit and be like, I disapprove of this. Like, oh, this is what's going on here? Well, I disapprove. She's a politician. This is, yeah, Biscuit Oliver on the chained. That's Norway. That's like the average Norwegian prisoner. Like, you don't have to be Biscuit Oliver to be able to do this shit. You just have to do a crime in Norway. She's a Tory MP. Your assumptions about her are 100% correct. Prison's so good. Probably get arrested on purpose. Profit share is theft. Tories probably. Thatcher is spinning in her grave. How dare they try to reform the prisoners? We should beat the crime out of them. Yeah, demonstrably has worked, by the way, of course. Notoriously has worked in countries, especially like the United States of America, where you see like the most extreme version of that. Clearly, that's why there is no crime in the United States, notoriously. Watch Anne Widdecombe, Louis Theroux, shit's hard. No, I, this is like the opposite of like a Louis Theroux or a, oh my God, I can't believe I'm forgetting his name now. Shit, come on. The chef guy. Dude, do you guys ever forget like normal things that you know so well? Yeah, Anthony Bourdain. Thank you. Jesus Christ. Can't believe I forgot the name of Anthony Bourdain. It's like, so it's, you, where did it go? In my mind, where did that information go? Someone describe to me how the brain works, please. Like, I know that as well as my own name. How do I forget that? Where the did it go for that brief moment? I know everything. I know, I know all about it. Where did it go? You lost that info in order to remember I'm black? Probably, probably. And that your brother, is the one of the people in crime time and that you're in Venice. I know everything, dude. I remember too much about chat. It's not good. It's literally bad. It is. I just need to like purge you from my brain a little bit. Or no, he lives in Venice. And that, no, I mean, he's like a famous wrestler. He passed away last year, saving his child in the sea, right? In a riptide. Anyway, parasocial streamer. Yes. Now everyone's going to say, you don't know me. Well, say something about me, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Shut up. We're watching this now.
There's a riot. Lie down immediately.
But does Halden Prison actually work?
Do you do an intimate search?
Well, not inside of them.
And what is prison for, if not punishment?
Dude, even his voice is perfect. Even her voice is perfect.
Oh, what is prison?
Have a way to know when it's gone through.
Yes.
So we give them corn.
I thought I'd seen it all, but I was wrong.
Let's be clear. Prison works. It ensures that we are protected from murderers, muggers, and rapists.
When I was prisons minister back in the 1990s...
Oh my God, this prisons minister in the 90s. Oh no, she is... Oh, Jesus Christ, dude. Oh my Lord. Oh, the vibes were so... I am so good at vibe checking, dude. I saw one look at her haircut and I was like, that's one, a TERF, okay? But that's from the accent. Two, Tory.
The government believed that prison was meant to be a stern place. A deterrent as well as a punishment.
We will scrap early release. You will be detained, you will be dealt with speedily, and you will be...
Jail for just that. Bro, she looks like a Dark Souls boss, dude. What is this? Oh no. Oh no. Oliver Tree looking ass with the haircut. Yep.
Remove zero tolerance.
But were we right? Today.
Bro, you're talking about zero tolerance. Who's tolerating your hair, dude? What did you do? Did you go to the barber and you literally put a bowl over your head and were like, cut the rest of this, my good sir?
Our prisons are
she had a glow up, not gonna lie. That's funny.
At the seams and stacked full of repeat offenders. I've heard that prisons in Norway are very different. More maximum comfort than maximum security. And their reoffending rates are the lowest in the world. So I'm on my way to Halden Prison, which
bro,
I'm...
She woke up that day and was like, I'm going to look like a villain. Like, it's just, she can't help it. She literally was just like, I would like to look like a villain. That's right. I'm going to do this to myself. Deacons of the Deep looking ass. Yeah, literally. I don't know anything about her background, but just I know everything about her background just by looking at her. It's so good.
Hell is the most luxurious of them all.
I think the phrase decent but austere sums up my idea of what imprisonment is. You're not being taken off to a hotel for a few months or a few years. You're being taken to a place of incarceration. So you should know every day that you're in prison.
Halden was built in 2010 as a groundbreaking experiment and houses some of Norway's most dangerous men.
Fairly typical prison entrance. First thing you notice is the wall, of course.
The thing about people in prison is that they just don't know that they're in prison. That's why you have to remind them. Like, you're literally saying, like, you know, torture these. That's it. Also, once again, you know, a draconian approach like the one in America is demonstrably a failure. It's immoral, okay? But it's also a failure.
The lights.
Hello.
Hello. I'm Anne Widdecombe. I've come to visit your prison.
What is your name?
Anne Widdecombe.
I am told that behind these walls is a prison unlike any I visited before. And I've been to over 135 prisons.
Oh my God, she just goes to prisons for
Good
fun,
morning.
Bro, this lady.
Can I see your ID, please?
ID, yes. My okay. EU passport, not for much longer.
This is a maximum security prison. There are men here who have committed very disturbing crimes, including murder, rape, and child abuse.
I am utterly used to spending my time amidst all sorts of criminals, from the very small right up to the multiple murderers, and indeed, in my day, the IRA. I don't shudder away from that. That's as normal as blueberry pie.
So, do you know anything about this prison?
I'm told it's more like a hotel than a prison.
With room service and stuff, is that what you
think? Well, I doubt if you have room service.
Okay.
But I'm told that you have ensuite facilities and the rooms.
Yeah.
And that the rooms are quite nice.
Yeah.
I mean, if this is anything like I've been told, I get the impression they might want to come back again.
Halden is Norway's second largest prison. It cost £138 million to build and was designed not to look or feel like a prison. Living this life of luxury are 40 murderers, 20 rapists, and 20 child molesters. Oh, and it's also home to around 60 drug dealers.
This is the area where the inmates come for the first time.
Now, the first thing I notice here is there isn't a bar in sight.
No, you won't see that, I guess, almost nowhere around the prison.
No bars. Right.
You will be surprised.
I would be very surprised. What's your escape rate?
Zero.
No escapes?
Mm.
What sort of prisoners are you getting here?
Every kind of...
You're very violent ones.
Yeah. We are a maximum security prison.
And no bars?
No.
In this maximum security prison?
No.
Mm. Right. If you're in prison in Britain, you know every single minute of every hour of every day that you are in prison. You're not allowed to forget it.
Whereas here, that's the point.
We meet them here and we greet them with a handshake
Yes.
Yes?
Yeah,
like
that's,
this?
That's all right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we then we can kind of get feel.
I didn't say they wanted to hug you, could they?
No.
Good. Good. I am glad there are limits somewhere.
We have limits. Yeah, we do.
Well, I've never been to a prison without bars before. And welcoming inmates with a friendly handshake does seem a bit odd. But there's one thing that's rife in prisons all over the world, and it requires more than a firm handshake to root out.
So this is where we strip search the inmates, taking all their belongings and give them our clothing.
Do you do an intimate search?
Well, not inside of them. But
you don't? What happens if they've got drugs inside them?
We search their mouth and we ask them to sit down like this when they're off clothing. And if something pops out, then we know. But we're not allowed to search
anything. But
you don't
actually do an intimate search. So they could have drugs.
They could have drugs, yeah. They could.
This is a maximum security prison. But just say to yourself, maximum security prison. It's not an open prison. It's not even what we would call a Cat C trainer. This is a maximum security prison.
So far, it's all been a bit too relaxed for my liking, and I am baffled by the lack of intimate drug searches. There are 60 drug dealers here, for goodness sake. Although at this point, there don't seem to be many of them around.
It's a bit like an empty school. I don't get the impression that there are more than 200 inmates here. Now, you go into a UK prison, and you go through the gate onto the landings, through the door onto the landings, and it is just a seething mass of prisoners. It's a different atmosphere altogether. You try going into Wandsworth.
I'm curious to see what a typical cell looks like, which here they cheerfully call rooms.
Now I will reveal the luxury room.
Let's have a look at that
and see what your mind is after we've seen it.
Oh.
What do you think about this?
Well, first thing that hits me between the eyes is there are no bars on the window.
Yeah.
Well, why don't they just get out?
Because the glass is like this thick.
My golly.
Yeah.
Their own fridge.
Their own fridge also. And they got their own bathroom.
My golly, they even got a shower.
They even got a shower.
The en-suites I can live with. I don't know about the fridge. I mean, I'm amazed they haven't got a mini bar in their fridge. I mean, television.
Yeah.
They lie here on their beds and they watch television.
Yeah. They can watch the news. They can see what's happening outside in the society. When they're going back, they can keep up with the society.
Well, I suppose I should be grateful they haven't got a DVD player.
They do.
Hmm. If they're in for a long time and they've got wives, do they have conjugal visits?
Yeah.
They do?
They can get visits 2 times a week.
Yes.
And whatever happens in that room, it's up to them.
They can have sex?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
So we've got sex, television, fridges. Right, okay.
Like you have on the outside, like a normal life on the outside, isn't it?
Yes, but the idea is, if you go to prison, it's not a normal life.
I'm raising my eyebrows at such facilities. Surely being in prison means losing not just your liberty, but some of your home comforts too. I want to meet one of these pampered prisoners, so I'm going to see someone whose crime is so serious that he's got one of the longest sentences in Norway. South of Oslo and 10 minutes drive from the Swedish border is Norway's flagship prison, Halden. Inmates here live campus style in fully equipped apartment blocks that they share with 9 other men. I'm about to meet Kirsten. He's serving a very long sentence, but it's not the done thing to ask for details.
It's a convention in prisons. I mean, you just don't confront somebody and say, what did you do then? Are you Kirsten?
Yeah, I'm Kirsten.
I'm Anne.
Hi, Anne.
Yeah?
Nice
Hello.
To meet you.
Hi.
Would you like some coffee or tea?
Oh, I could kill a cup of coffee. Thank you.
You want some sugar or milk?
No sugar, but I would like milk, please.
Uh-huh. I have a sentence of 20 years.
He got a very, very big sentence. He didn't just fiddle threepence off the bus fare. You know, he's done something which is very wrong. But it must have been quite a relief to come here.
I didn't believe that the way they treat me, like what they have an agenda, you know?
Yes.
A secret agenda.
Yeah.
You can see the guards treat us nice. We are treating each other nice. And actually, it's not so bad to stay here. I have nothing to complain about.
Yeah, you're quite happy here.
Yeah, in the fact that I know I have to be in prison, I have to say I'm happy that I am here and not other places that couldn't be worse, you know?
Kirsten's cellmates are either at the prison workshops or out on day release.
And so they'll all come back at the same time from the work?
Yeah, more or less. We have this guy, he have a permission, I don't know, so he's allowed to going out of the prison for 7 or 8 hours.
Is he?
Yeah, they do it for, you know, to get ready.
So even though it's a very high security prison, you can still go out?
You have to prove that they can have confidence in you.
Yeah. How many do you lose that way?
If we lose somebody, it's like that. I don't have any exact number, but we have lost a few guys.
Some don't come back. They just don't come back. Now that really is quite tough on the population, because it means there's a criminal loose out there who shouldn't be.
But it's a big difference from this prison and a prison in England.
Oh, this one is. Yeah, this one is very different. I haven't seen anything like this in England. I've been into 135 UK prisons, and in very, very few of them could I see this sort of setup working. The number of fights in UK prisons and assaults on staff, and it's just different.
It's my second day at Holden. After hearing about a few prisoners not returning from day release, I need some reassurance that the officers really are in control. So Armand and Linda take me down a secret underground tunnel to see one of their rarely used rooms.
Tactical room.
Right, so this is when you've got a situation.
Yeah, when we've got a situation, we have to dress up to be prepared.
Good heavens. How many of you are trained in riot control?
Everybody.
Everybody?
Yeah.
And how many times have you been in riot gear over the last year?
One time for me, and that was during night time.
Mm.
Right, yeah.
But totally, like, the last past year, I guess, 5 to 10 times, perhaps.
Right.
Yeah.
That's heavy stuff. Well, actually, be quite strong just to wear it all. Yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't like to be clonked with that. That's very heavy. Yeah.
No. And we have different ones that is harder as well.
Harder than
that? Mm. This is kind of a training baton.
Be careful not to kill him.
It's for to stop him. It's not like when he's already down.
What if he's trying to get up?
Well, as soon as we are many officers, like five or six, like we told you, and we will just rush up on him and lay him down.
Can I see somebody in riot gear?
Yes, we have Monta here.
Ah. It's very impressive.
Utenpå.
It's actually quite difficult to imagine this being needed here. Whereas in some of the big prisons that I've seen in the UK, you think, where's the riot gear? Almost before you start. There we go. Now you look even fiercer. Are we in a standoff? So you've got a prisoner coming up to you, threatening. What do you do?
We have to push him.
Yes.
On the wall.
Against the wall.
On the wall.
Right, okay, yeah. Okay.
And have control on them on the backside.
Yeah. Oh, you so-and-so. No, you're being very gentle. Push on me.
Yes, we are, because we can move against you.
Yeah, don't worry, you won't get me on the floor.
No.
Good. Let's say that's the wall.
Yeah.
Say that's the wall.
Yeah.
And I do this, then what happens?
If you don't stop, then you get hit with a...
Then I get hit with one of those, yeah. No, that was fine, but you were being very gentle. You'd be much rougher than that, wouldn't you? You're back in your normal gear now.
Yes.
That's how you're going to get around.
Mm. Okay, bye.
Bye. I've never seen scooters in UK prisons. Whether they do now, I don't know. Certainly not in my time. I never once saw a scooter. They tend to run.
I'm coming. There's a riot. Lie down immediately. Lie down, lie down. I've got a baton. Lie on the floor. Lie on the floor.
It's hard to imagine a riot here, and I've yet to see more than one or two prisoners together. It's such a calm atmosphere that I'm starting to wonder if they're allowed to stay in bed all day.
So where are they all now?
So most of the inmates are in the workshops.
This is a car workshop?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So here you also can get a degree.
I bet this is popular.
Yeah.
This is Norway's first garage behind bars. Raymond is on the mechanics course. He's serving time for murder and has the ominous nickname, the Grill Master. Oh, I'm not going to ask why.
Since you've been doing this, what's it done for you?
It's all right for the head, for to try to get the day to be normal. Yeah. Otherwise, I think a lot about the avdeling, so it's good to strike a little, find something there. Mm.
Do you want to do something with cars when you leave?
Vil du jobbe med biler når du går ut?
I work with cars when I was 13 years old. So I do
much. So you've always liked cars?
Yeah. It's my hobby.
Yeah.
Jolly good.
All the courses here, from mechanics and carpentry to printing and sheet metalwork, are run by professionals.
So,
hello.
Hi.
Hello.
So this is Grib.
Grib?
Yes. Welcome.
Hello. Hello, Grib. That's hello. A funny name.
Yeah, it's my nickname.
What does it mean?
Oh, it's a vulture in Norwegian.
Vulture?
Yeah.
Dear me, what have you done to get a nickname like that?
I got a tattoo.
Ah,
in the age of 14. So
okay.
Not my proudest moment, but...
So what happens in this workshop?
We make people professional welders and sheet metal worker in actually this room.
And do you account for all the tools very carefully?
Yeah. Every morning, that's the first thing I do. I go around the shop
and
see that everything is here. And I do the same thing
because
in the afternoon.
We've had people make some very funny things in our metal shop. One even used tubes for a gun.
Yeah.
So we're terribly, terribly careful. But you've got everything sort of just out.
Everything is available for the students. So if they really want to hurt me, they can.
Inmates can be very inventive with the right equipment, and by golly, there are lots of dangerous tools lying around, not to mention expensive ones.
And who pays for all these machines?
Dedication department, yes.
Right. They pay for all of this?
Yeah. The students get the best machinery, and they are trained on the same machinery that the industry use.
You couldn't fault the workshops. They were magnificently equipped. They are working for proper, formal qualifications. They're not just messing about. I would bite their hands off for those workshops in British prisons. I really would. How are you?
Thank you. I'm good, you?
I'm Anne.
Eunice, my name.
Eunice. Hello, Eunice.
Eunice is serving time for drug dealing and attempted murder.
How long have you got to go, sentence to go?
I have my sentence, my complete sentence is 13 and a half year.
13?
13 and a half years.
Right. Yes. Okay.
Yes. I told them I want to go in Halden.
Why?
We are here and we have very lucky. We have many options, so we can take education. This is very important. I cannot come out from prison with nothing, with just a bag in my hand. Then I'm going to go back to the same.
So you applied to come here. How long did it take before you came?
3 days.
3 days?
Yes.
That's quick.
Yes.
They must have discharged an awful lot of people.
I was escaped. When my case happened, I escaped. When I make deal with the police to come back, I told them in the deal, I want to go in Ullish Mor Halden. They say, okay, when you come back, we're going to fix. That's why it took 3 days.
So you bargained with the police for where you were going to go to prison?
Yes.
They gave in and said you could come here, and then you came back?
Yes.
I must say, I don't think you would find that happening in the UK.
I don't think so.
Bro, obviously I'm not a, Tory prison minister, but after looking at the way, like, I don't know if it's the conditioning or if it's like just like living in America for so long, but like I love this. Obviously I love this, but my God, dude, that shit is crazy. Like the way that it is definitely like, it is extremely empathetic. Did you teleport? Yeah, I did. No, I was whipping up some good shit, dude. That's what I was doing while watching, of course. But the kitchen camera is still not ready. She is the Mrs. Puff from SpongeBob of prison. These dudes live better than me as an office shop guy. Dude, 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 dude. Dude, people, whenever Americans watch like how other countries, especially like Norway, treats its prisoners, they forget that like these motherfuckers are still in prison, bro. It's still, so like think about the average citizen. The average citizen's experience is even better than this, okay? People in America, like average everyday salarymen in America, live a worse life than Norwegian prisoners do. Your immediate reaction shouldn't be to like, oh man, that these guys should have a worse situation overall. They should have worse living conditions overall. It should be to, you know, recognize how awful this country treats its own citizens that haven't even done crimes, let alone those who do. Okay, that should motivate you to advocate for better conditions for yourself rather than, you know, get upset and mad that like people in Norway are doing well. But of course, when I say stuff like that, I'm branded as a communist, radical, extremist, Marxist, gender threat to America, all of that sort of stuff. So like, why can't we do this? Like, what's stopping us from treating each other in a more empathetic way and also improving the material conditions that everyone exists under, like all working class people exist under in the United States of America? What's preventing you from watching the top of the hour ads at the top of every hour? Well, the only thing preventing you from seeing the ads at the top of the hour, if you no longer want to, is a $5 a month subscription or a free one in the form of a Twitch Prime. That's right. Americans are like, no, I'm going to sit there and I'm going to watch this ad. But smart Norwegians are like, I will subscribe to you with my Twitch Prime for free, or I will subscribe to you for $5 because I'm smart and don't want to see the ads and also think it's worth it. That's just how it works. Okay, here's the woman ad break now.
An escaped prisoner would bargain with the police for where he was going to go to prison. Right, well, that's a fascinating insight. I can't imagine this happening in the UK. I mean, the public would be scandalized. I mean, I think the police's answer in Britain would be the right one is, no, Sonny, you come back and then we'll decide where to send you.
Still reeling from Eunice's revelation, it was another shock.
I don't get it. Like, why is she looking at a demonstrably successful system that is significantly more empathetic and better? And in the face of like the overwhelming evidence that this shit, like treating humans as humans, actually does work better than the current way that she has done shit, how is she still angry and vindictive almost? Like, if you stare at the face of this, if you're staring at prosperity, if you're staring at empathy and you still go, no, I think our solution would be to beat the shit out of you, it would be better overall, then you're just an evil piece of shit. Like, how are you gonna look at someone thriving or a societal formation that is like just better and still get mad and go, no, Sonny, this is still wrong.
Just round the corner. Hello.
Hey.
Hello.
How are you?
Well, what's going on here?
We got Jelani doing his thing.
It's this ghastly rap stuff. Hey,
you wouldn't have listened to Norwegian rap. Put Jelani, pull us right here. This is Norwegian rap for you.
Well, it doesn't matter what sort of rap it is. It's all horrible.
Well, I'm all for workshops, but spending money on rap, I'm not sure about.
Oh my God, I love her. I love her so much.
Right, what do they actually learn here?
Well, I think they learn to express themselves.
Do they learn this? Do they learn how to handle all this?
Yes, the technical part of it, yes.
These guys are in rehabilitation. I mean, the prison system is in Norway is built on the idea of rehabilitation. And through art, you can achieve a lot just by learning to express yourself and own your situation.
I'm gonna be honest, dude, looking at Norwegians and the way they live, how are we the same species? Like, literally, how are we humans and they're also humans? Like, what is going on? It's like they live on a different planet, dude.
The good things and the bad things. And these guys are writing lyrics about the predicaments that got them here in the first place.
Yeah. I'm absolutely not into rap.
Some have been here.
And I don't actually regard that as particularly purposeful activity.
28-year-old Yolani is serving 5 years at Halden. I'm sure he won't say what for, so we better stick to chatting about rap.
Are they decent?
They're decent.
No swear words.
No swear words.
Oh, I'll go and have
I just have one swear
have
word because, you know...
I can cope with that.
No excuse. But
that's fine. Yeah. Okay, right. Do a line in Norwegian.
Gi meg blikk og se ned når jeg kommer inn.
Oh, you're joking.
That means,
you're absolutely
that means
joking.
Like, they give me, they look at me when I come in, they look at me and look down. Because you're the
Norwegian
boss, right?
Norwegian is the most terrible language.
Gi meg blikk.
Gi meg blikk.
Og se ned.
Og se ned.
Når jeg kommer inn.
Something, something million.
Når.
Når.
Jeg.
How dare you, you stupid women! How dare you? We must make England, Denland once more!
Jeg.
Kommer.
Kommer.
In.
In.
Yes. Gi meg blikk.
Gi meg blikk.
Og se ned.
Og se ned.
Når jeg.
Når jeg.
Kommer inn.
Kommer hjem.
Woo!
Did I think it had a huge rehabilitative value? Well, I would say no, but they would say yes.
I don't know, maybe they know more than you, dude. Who knows?
Well, this is all very nice, but these men are criminals, not pop stars. Where's the punishment?
This is a spa, it's a holiday resort, it's a hotel. Yeah, I actually think I've had a good time here, I've benefited. I'm not scared of committing any crime, knowing that I can come to a place like this.
What?
I'm at Halden Prison in Norway, where inmates appear to live in the lap of luxury. It's a maximum security prison, so I'm shocked to learn that inmates are allowed visits from wives and girlfriends twice a week in a private room.
This is the more common visit room that we have.
No window?
No window, because here girlfriends can come.
Just tell me, what is to stop either drugs being passed by the girlfriend or more.
Bro, why is she so caught up with the drug shit? Like, this is her main concern. What about drugs that are coming into prison? Why can't you do it, cavity search? They don't care, man. Like, what's gonna happen, dude? Someone's gonna do drugs there? Okay, chill. It was so funny in the beginning of the video, like in the earlier parts of it, where she was like, there's 30 rapists, 25 murderers, and worst of all, 65 drug dealers. Like she put a pause before and was like, there's drug dealers here. So much worse than the other things. Like, they are going to be bringing drugs and doing drugs in prison. I hate drugs.
More importantly, criminal information being passed by the man to the girl. What's to stop that?
What criminal information?
I don't think they pass on so much criminality because here it's more girlfriend, boyfriend situation.
Oh, right.
We do provide
towels. Yes.
Sheets and condoms.
Sheets and the necessary.
Yeah.
Right.
The necessary.
Do they have to clean up after themselves?
Dude. Ultimately, like, man, I love Tori so much. Like, this woman has never enjoyed laughter. But if you were to ask her, like, hey, what did you think about the Dave Chappelle special? 100% a TERF. You know what I mean? Dave Chappelle is siding with this person, okay? When Dave Chappelle said, I'm Team TERF, that's Team TERF, okay? Straight up. That's why I was, like, blown away by, like, the fact that Dave said something so stupid.
Well, I do hope so.
Yeah, we don't do that.
I do hope so.
Yeah.
I can't imagine an easier recipe for exchanges of drugs, exchanges of criminal information.
Like what?
What's a criminal? A man and his wife, or a man.
Bro, what is criminal information exchange? Like what? Like what is she worried about, bro? They have like access to everything. What part of the reason why people do more crimes in prison is because the living conditions in prison are so awful that people wanna, you know, get ahead. Like smuggling drugs in the prison half the time, or smuggling contraband in the prison half the time, is so that you can have an upper hand and like be treated like a human being, at least amongst the other people that you're surrounded by. What's he gonna sell drugs for? Oh, what about the criminal information?
And in anybody for that matter, just shut away, unsupervised, for hours on end.
Linda has been a prison officer for 8 years. and she's seen a lot of different reactions to Halden in her time.
When I hear the criticism that it's very luxurious, well, it's a prison. They are not allowed to go out when they want. They're being told where to go, when to go there by us. But what matters to them is that we treat them nicely, that we talk with them with respect. If there's any luxurious, it's that we're human and we're showing off humanity to them.
Yeah, that's the luxury.
Linda takes me to the prison library, which I've been dying to see. I'm all for broadening prisoners' horizons, but I was appalled at something I discovered there. Prisoners can look up their own crimes and those of their fellow inmates in the Norwegian Criminal Chronicles.
Dear me. Surely they don't think it's a mark of honour to be in here, do they?
Well, some do, I think. To think it's...
Wait, what? So? That was... that's what's appalling to you? Bro, her priorities are so fucked, dude. I love this. I love her. I love her so much. She's just like, it's like she's such a, like a villain. She's like a cartoonish villain. This is like, she's out of Harry Potter. Like, I don't know how else to describe it. Like, it's just hilariously self-unaware. It's like a crime yearbook.
They open it, they say, this is me. That's what I did.
We don't go quite that far.
No.
Is there anything in the last 8 years that's really alarmed you that, you know, you thought, I don't like that?
Yeah, I don't like conflicts.
Yeah,
I'm a person that don't go into arguments very often.
Yeah.
But I do when I have to, but yeah. I don't enjoy it. And I
Damn, bro, they just like, in Norwegian prison, they just debate you, I guess. Like, I don't like conflicts, but sometimes I have to debate prisoners, and that's not good because, you know, debate lording is inhumane. Subjecting someone to debate lording is inhumane. It's coercive, especially because of the power that we have over the prisoners, and we just subject them to that, and it hurts when I do that.
I think that's when it's get loud, someone spits at me.
Really?
Because I think I don't deserve that.
Yeah.
So I think that's really annoying.
That depresses you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It does. Yeah. So, but then again, you need to be strict. You need to put down the foot and you need to tell them.
What's the suicide rate here?
Oh, we've had a few ones, but I think over the 10 years we've been open, we've had 3 or 4.
Well, 3 or 4 in 10 years.
Yeah.
Bad. What effect does that have on the unit when that happens?
Oh, it affects us a lot.
Yeah, but the other prisoners on the unit?
Same.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the people that are knowing this person are all, either you're an inmate or if you're staff, we all feel it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because this is something we don't want.
No.
Quite. I mean, I joked when I said zero, but like, no, it's literally zero.
Yeah.
Sadly, our prisoner suicide rates in the UK are considerably higher, almost 100 a year for the last couple of years. Our reoffending rates are shocking too, at 70%. I want to talk to the governor, R.A. Hoidl, to find out how Norway has managed to reduce its reoffending.
I wonder how they're able to do that. I wonder why their suicide rate is so low and how their reoffender rate is also low. What's the deal with that? Very curious. It's like walking into like a room where there's signs that say like, this is the reason, and being like, I am terrified by the prospect. I can't see. I don't understand it.
The recidivism rate in Norway is what at the moment?
No, it's 25% after 5 years. But it hasn't been always so good.
Right.
When I started in this business in the 80s, it was 60, 70%.
70% recidivism.
Yeah. So we have
done. So what's brought it from 70 to 25?
In the early 80s, 70s, the prison officers was just guards. Just take care of the security work. But in the middle of the 90s, we changed the whole prison officer role. So they also should work with rehabilitation, help the inmates, more like a social worker. So we have a dual role in after.
25% still seems kind of high. Dude, 25% is literally nothing, bro. Are you insane? There's always going to be people there's always going to be people that want to do crimes, dude. Are you out of your mind? My man literally talked about a, like, nearly, I mean, he talked about it going from 80 to 25% as they changed their approach to how they punish crime. Over half a decade.
Of the 90s.
Well, that is interesting. Our reoffending rates now are as high as Norway's were 40 years ago. So it shows how far they've managed to reduce them. Our prison officers are busy, and I don't know that they would have time to engage quite this far. Armand has been a prison officer for 18 years, and he's been at Halden since it was built.
Don't judge people, because we're not supposed to do that when we're here. We work with every kind of offenders, like sex offenders, drug addicts, murderers, everything. I'm here just to try to help them to get better when they get out of prison, because we don't have any death penalty in Norway, and we don't have any prisoners are being inside for life. They're going back out again.
Once they do leave Halden, I wouldn't be surprised if inmates might even miss some of the services on offer.
I'm going to look into a dentist surgery. I don't know why, but I am. And apparently the dentist comes once or twice a week, which is a jolly sight more than...
That's it. It's done. Norwegian prison conditions, living conditions, are literally better than people living in the Appalachians, okay?
Like,
if you're literally a working class American, out of a job, have like a regular minimum wage job in West Virginia, you straight up have like a probably 40 to 90% worse life than a prisoner in Norway. Communism, brother!
We do in the UK.
It's like you find on the outside.
My golly.
Yeah.
Look at that! It's a fully equipped dentist surgery.
Like, she's mad. Why are you mad that they're getting health care? What kind of villain are you? This is cartoonish to get upset at human beings getting medical facilities is literally just straight villain. No, that even like even some villains would probably still be like, yeah, that's fine. Like, it's like not even cartoonish at this point.
Yeah.
And the dentist comes how often?
Once or twice a week.
Once or twice a week.
Mm.
No, that is terrific.
Mm.
That really is, yeah.
It's good, I think.
I was going to say, this is replicating the outside world. Actually, it's better than the outside world. That is certainly much better than any ordinary law-abiding citizen in the UK could expect.
And if that wasn't deluxe enough, I was in for another shock around the corner.
Why? You guys have a national healthcare system. I wonder why. I wonder why, you Tory asshole. I wonder why it's better. You're directly responsible for why it's not better. Once I found that she was like a part of like the Thatcherite government, it's like, it's a wrap, dude. She literally is personally responsible for the shit being bad for the UK. Okay? She did that.
Something that wouldn't go amiss in any English village.
Oh my gosh, well, this is a real shock. I could shop it and do it quite well.
Apparently, inmates can go shopping in small groups and buy groceries to cook their evening meal together.
We're talking here that you can really produce a nutritious meal with fresh stuff. I mean, what's not to like? So they're learning real serious cooking. Yes, I don't like sushi. I don't like raw stuff. Yuck, yuck, yuck.
Oh God, what a humorless twat, dude. Holy shit. Yuck, yuck, yuck. I don't like Norwegian either. What a silly, dastardly language. I hate hearing different languages.
Yuck.
Brexit means Brexit, bruv.
I mean, I wouldn't want them living on caviar every day of the week, but I see no reason why a prisoner should not get the full range of food if they're learning from it. But if you're going to come out and you're going to mix in normal society...
Bro, she can't even can give them normal food without putting a condition on it. Like, if they're learning from it, how about they get normal food because they're humans, dude? I don't know. Like, You're missing the point. You're missing the point from top to bottom, start to finish. And they keep yelling at you the point. They're like, we love to treat people with empathy and respect. This is why we have low rates of recidivism. What are you doing? And she's like, I don't understand it. It's devastating. They can read about their own crimes in there for book inside of books.
And you're gonna cook for a family and you're gonna cook for friends. It does you no harm if you've learned to do various things. And they will make a mess of it from time to time. Just like life. And that's the idea here, it replicates life. I think if you tried to do that in Britain, there would be a public resistance.
And a mini supermarket isn't the only thing that you'd never find in a UK prison. Here, the prisoners really can have a home away from home.
So what's that?
A visiting house for daddies in prison.
Daddies in prison?
Yeah, they have to go a daddy in prison course before they can use this.
Right.
A program.
So they have to pass the test.
Pass the test and have to go through the program. And then they can have overnight stays with the kids and their wives, or if there are girlfriends, I don't know if they're married.
They can have wives and girlfriends.
Well, not at the same time.
No, just one.
My
so
man.
They can sort of live as a family?
Yeah.
For what, two nights?
One night, maybe two nights during weekend.
One or two nights during the weekend?
Yeah.
Right, okay. Well, that certainly wouldn't happen.
She's like physically upset. I love it. I love this guy, by the way, but like, look at her face.
Right.
She's like so sad. This is the greatest documentary. I'm so glad we're watching this. This is the funniest thing I've watched on this broadcast as far as documentaries goes. She's such a miserable. Oh my God. She is such a miserable old witch, dude. Holy shit. What a joyless, humorless, horrifying person. How sad must her life be?
Okay. Well, that certainly wouldn't happen in the UK.
No.
No.
Well, it's about getting to connect with the kids again. Maybe some of them haven't had any connection with their kids for a long time.
Har et barn, 10 måneder gammel, samboer, sitter på femårsdom her i Halden for noe jeg egentlig ikke har gjort.
Får du besøkshus og sånt, eller?
Ikke noe besøkshus, dessverre.
Du burde jo nesten få det da, fra fengselet her.
Eller? Det er en komplisert, det er en komplisert sak, men enkelt fortalt så handler det om på en måte fortiden min og hvem som er inkludert i, kall det lovbruddet med anførselstegn.
Professional radio producer Mina visits Halden once a month to produce a talk radio show presented by the inmates.
Punishment for criminal behavior in Norway is prison. Like everywhere else, you lose your freedom. The thing that you cherish the most, being able to
Norwegian Adam 22.
make your own decisions. That's gone. So it doesn't really matter if there's a studio there, if the walls are white. That can just help you not go totally insane till you are let out, because we're not in the Middle Ages. If we were, I would say, I mean, throw away the key if that's what you want to do. But they're going to move next door. Their kids are going to go to the same school as your kids. So don't be an idiot. I mean, do you want to lock somebody in a tiny room and then think everything is going to be okay when you let them out 15 years later?
Hvis jeg går på fulltid på den dommen her, så har jeg sittet 10 år i fengselen min. Jeg har ikke fylt 28 år engang.
Rather than bottling their anger up, inmates are given the chance to broadcast their grievances about life in prison to the nation.
Og dere som kriminelle, hva den beste måten å straffe dere på?
This is unironically, but like, this is what Republicans think will happen if prisoners can vote. And of course, on its face, like, this is not a problem. This is a good thing. We should do this. But also on top of that, like, they're broadcasting their sentences and whatnot. And it's like, okay, why is that an issue? What happened? Are they now like in favor of, I don't know, more crimes in Norway now? Prisoners can't vote in the U.S. Are you kidding me, dude? This is the most European ass comment. Prisoners can't vote in the U.S. Dude, if you've been a prisoner, you can't vote in the United States. In the state of Florida, okay, the people, in a ballot measure, in the most democratic way possible, the state of Florida people said, we want felons to be able to vote. Like, if you've served your sentence and you're out of prison, you should be able to vote. And the governor, who barely won, by the way, by like a very tiny margin, literally executed a poll tax. So prisoners who served their time still can't vote unless they pay off their debts, which, by the way, can range anywhere from like hundreds of dollars to hundreds of thousands of dollars. How is that legal? It's America. We don't care. This is a continuation of slavery. This is a continuation of, you know, being able to have a permanent underclass that you can point to and you can abuse and abuse for slave labor and numerous other things.
Som gjør at dere aldri gjør det
igjen. Kan ikke drive og skremme folk til ikke gjøre noe. Hva faen, vi lever i 2020. Det er jo billigere da å få deg rehabilitert, så du slipper å komme tilbake, så du slipper å koste staten noe mer, så du kan bli betale skatt du også, bro.
Ja, betale en million i skatt i løpet av livet ditt, mann. Du har noe å gi tilbake
igjen. Bygge opp landet i stedet for å ødelegge det.
So you just get them going with communication. Because when your communication has been fuck this and fuck that and hitting and going nuts for every little tiny thing, now they're communicating.
Så det kom, det liksom, jeg mener at det kommer veldig mye an på deg selv, da.
Yeah.
Hva du vil gjøre videre med livet ditt.
Given a straight choice, would I put my money on somebody coming out here? Staying out of trouble and somebody coming out of your average UK prison staying out of trouble. Well, there's no doubt about it. There's no contest. My money would go on the chap coming out of here.
One man who did eventually come out of here was once known as the most dangerous man in all of Norway. And it's about time I met him. It's my last day at Halden Prison. And it certainly has been eye-opening. But while it's luxurious in many ways, even prison officers here know there's nothing glamorous about searching for drugs.
Right, what have we got here?
We are going to see a special toilet.
Right.
It's for drugs control. Sometimes, if they have drugs on them,
they get them inside.
They get them inside them.
By the way, to the people who are saying, what did he jaywalk? First of all, there are notorious criminals in Norway. I mean, Anders Breivik comes to mind. It was notorious even for America, but that happens like, you know, once every 10, if not 100 years. And Anders Breivik is not in that prison. But of course, the prison that he's in is still incredibly humane. Like the treatment that he's subjected to is insanely humane despite his notorious crimes. Also, Anders Breivik is never getting out of prison. Let's be real.
The mouth?
Yeah.
And then we bring him here.
Yes.
And this is the other side of the window.
Right.
Because when we are doing this kind of control...
Can I have a hand, please?
Yes, of course. And we have two guards on this side of the window. And we see only that way.
Yes.
He doesn't see us.
No.
And due to the control bit, after he went to the toilet, it's this machine who starts to work. And it's cleaning up what he's
been... Yes, quite.
Yeah. And it comes out on the other side here. That's how.
Anders Breivik is a white supremacist, mass murdering terrorist. He went to an island. He blew up bombs and also simultaneously went to an island where, like, the liberal party was getting together, like a youth summit, and murdered, I think, 75. Is it 75 or 65? 69 kids, 7 adults. Yeah. He's, like... He got 21 years. That doesn't matter. He's gonna be in prison forever. They give him the maximum sentence, and then there is a concept like where they reevaluate at the end of your maximum sentence, where like 21 means your life. Okay, you're no matter what happens, like they're always going to reevaluate, and he is like dub. Like, I mean, I'm sorry, it's not ableism, but like he also not only is he a Nazi, but also on top of that, like, has like that's not, that guy's not coming out. Let's be real. They will prolong his sentence at the end of his term. It was the labor youth. He killed kids. Yeah.
How we find the drugs.
Yeah.
And we have a kind of a way to know when it's gone through. So we give them corn. So when we get the corn out, we know that.
Oh my God.
That it's been through the system. That's not nothing anymore is hiding.
Halden runs a specialist rehab unit where addicted inmates can get clean. One former addict who was treated here was Trond Eriksen. Trond's criminal career spanned armed robbery, kidnapping, and escaping from prison. He was so notorious that the press named him Norway's most dangerous man.
Jesus, that's so light. The thing I was going to say is, in Germany, correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I'm pretty sure that in Germany, it's not illegal to escape prison. I don't know how it is in Norway either, but you will be charged for stealing clothes from the prison itself. So if you escape, technically, if you escape naked, it's not illegal. Like, they don't add additional charges onto your sentence. But I think they can if you escape with clothes on, because it's like the property of the state. You're stealing the property of the state. And the reason why that is the case is because, like, everyone wants to be free. It's the most human condition is to want freedom. And they understand that. And that's why they say, like, it's understandable your desire to be free. So it's not an additional sentence. Like, it's not an aggravating factor or anything like that. Escaping from confinement is a natural human response. That's why. Yeah, exactly. It's considered unmanned nature to escape captivity. So it's not punished. Yeah, it's a basic human. It's like a totally basic human thing to want to escape confinement.
An addict from an early age, prison was his finishing school. But it was only when he came to Halden that Trond finally turned his life around.
Oh!
My first time in prison was in 1980. Then I was 14 years old.
Bro. Remember how the guy was saying the recidivism rate is high? This guy is single-handedly the reason why it was high, dude. It's like pointing to Anders Breivik and being like, well, actually, there's a lot of mass shootings per capita happening if you look at the victims over the course of the past 10 years in Norway. Like, it's like there's four prisoners and one of them kept, going back to prison. So that's why the rate was so high.
14 years and 3 weeks. So I was really young. I put the last shot with heroin outside these walls, 20 October 2010.
How were you taking a shot of heroin? Had you been released?
On the parking place.
And you'd been released?
No, when I was going in, before I go into the
you
prison.
You were coming in?
Where'd you get
the heroin from?
I took it from Oslo and I put the last shot outside the walls in the parking place.
And what was the moment that you remember when you decided it all had to change?
I think one of the most difficult thing for a person is to be honest with yourself, you know, to look yourself in the mirror and say, okay, you have done a lot of shit, really. Yeah. And to change this thing, you have to say goodbye to the drugs. You have to say goodbye to a lot of friends.
Now, supposing you hadn't come here, do you think you'd have just changed everything around any?
No chatter, this guy didn't kill 70 kids. That's Anders Breivik. This is a different person who was at the time considered to be Norway's most notorious criminal. I don't even think that they I don't even know if this documentary was, I guess this is a recent documentary. I don't know why they don't even cover him, but I feel like it's something that Norwegians don't talk about. Like, they see it as like it's like Stephen Paddock. Remember Stephen Paddock? Kind of weird that we just like completely gave up on what his motivations were. That was weird. That was kind of odd, but I just suspect that like Norwegians probably completely act like Anders Breivik wasn't a thing. You know what I mean? Chat, Stephen Paddock was the Las Vegas shooter. How the f*** do you not know who that is? Oh my Lord, dude. I mean, you're proving my point.
Anyway, simply because you'd had enough of field life.
I don't know, but because I meet Ari Høydahl, the chief of this prison.
Yes.
He has been following me since I was 14 years, you know?
Yeah.
And he said, you have to come to Halden to go to this drug floor, you know,
yeah,
for helping you. So he fixed me here, you know. So yeah. So Ari have been a really important person in my life. I have cost this society over 100 million Norwegian kroner. 100, that's true. And I can never pay that back.
It makes perfect sense to have rehabilitation at the center. I've always said this, I've said it so long and so loudly, but I've never listened to it. It actually makes perfect sense as a tool of public protection and of saving money.
Aside from practical help, it turns out there's spiritual help available too. Deep within the woods, Halden is running one of the most unusual courses I've ever come across. Inmates can opt out of general prison life for 21 days to attend a retreat.
Da tar jeg oss igjennom det vanlige ritualet. Da tror jeg vi kan starte med et par dype pust. Og så setter vi fokuset på kroppen vår. Vi setter oss godt til rette på såren.
Through silent meditation, rituals and reflection, led by the prison's chaplains, inmates are expected to be honest with themselves and confront what they've done.
Why do you think the retreat is so important?
It's because it changes people. It's a very good process that asks the question, who am I? What good, what bad in my life? How can things change? Who do I want to be? What am I longing for? It's all the big questions, and it's a lot of time in silence, and there is a fellowship.
Og jeg har lært meg, du vet, det som jeg elsker med retreat, den, fordi der folk behandles som en menneske, ikke som en innsatt. Jeg vet ikke aldri hva jeg får bare si, for å være helt ærlig, men det gleder meg, den, fordi jeg kan få de permisjonene, og jeg kan bruke mer tid med ungene.
How long have you been in prison?
I've been in prison 6 years.
6 years?
Yeah.
And how long here?
6 years.
You've done all 6 years here?
Yep.
Now, when you're going out to live a normal life, you're going back into the life that caused the problem. So no, how are you going to avoid time. That?
I have no contact with any of my friends from the past life.
So you think you were in bad company?
Some of them it was bad company, and some of them it was my own bad decision. So I cannot blame other people for my decision. I'm a grown person, and this was my decision. If I don't learn now, when am I going to learn?
Yeah.
I'm a grown man, so I think that I will live one free life without crime.
That's good. Well, good luck.
I'm coming to the end of my time at Halden, and it's certainly...
I really want her to be like, and I learned nothing. Like, I want her final conclusion to literally be, in spite of, like, all of the overwhelming evidence, for her to be like, I still think this is morally abhorrent. I want crime to go punished. I want to do it, not for rehabilitative reasons, but for my own personal experience.
You've given me food for thought.
It's been interesting. My problem with the whole thing is I'm very enthused about some things, really enthused. Some of which are extremely hard-edged, like the workshops. That's fine. I can say I wish every UK prison was like that. But when you look at the whole concept, and it's a very expensive concept at that, I want to be enthusiastic, but I've had too much experience in the past of being told that something was wonderful, of hearing...
Dog, you're literally looking at a success story. I told you. I've hauled it. What a dumbass, dude. What an actual... What a dumb person. Like, just... Some people just, like, see someone wearing, like, a Hillary Rodham pantsuit and assume, like, oh, this is a smart person. It's like, no, dude. This is just a literal dumbass. Oh, it's too costly. It's quite expensive, actually. It's like, first of all, prison is expensive regardless, dumbass. This actually achieves the results. I love when neoliberals, unironically, advocate for, like, shit government spending. A draconian, hammer-fisted approach to the way to treat crime and criminals demonstrably does not work. It is ineffective. So in its essence, you're just wasting money, okay? Because that's the ultimate goal of the criminal justice system, is to end crime. And if there are two approaches to it, one being the rehabilitation, two being the incarceration approach, and your incarceration approach clearly is not working, despite the amount of money that you spend on it, and the rehabilitative approach is working, then you literally are just wasting all your dollars right now. We don't talk about Anders Breivik because he wants to be talked about. He doesn't deserve to be talked about, only his victims and the actions that he did. But he himself only wants media attention, and that's not something he will get. Yeah, that makes sense. By the way, most Norwegian name ever, dude. My name is Dwarf Dwarfson, and I do not want to talk about Anders Breivik because he is always full of himself and wants to talk about him. Ending crime is possible with militant policing and retributive imprisonment. Yeah, no, that's why America has ended crime successfully, whereas in Norway, there's so much crime.
Loads, as we have here, loads of anecdotal evidence that it works and it's unique. And then some years down the line, when the statistics start to come through, it's really all rather disappointing.
When it was built 10 years ago, Halden was the first of its kind, a humane,
In a way, she's right. You can't import Norwegian prisons without the rest of the Norwegian society, like its welfare state. But of course, she's not going to do that because she's a Tory. I mean, there is truth to that. Yes, you can't just open up hotel-style prisons in a society where people are dying in the streets, okay? Like, then people are going to be like, yeah, of course I'm going to do crime. I want to go to the hotel prison. But once again, crime is not like a single solution type problem, okay? You can't just like be like, all right, hotel prisons. That's why crime is gone now. This will clear things up about her. She's married. She's never married nor had any children. In November 2007 on BBC Radio 4, she described how a journalist once produced a profile on her with the assumption that she had at least one sexual relationship, to which Widdecombe replied, "Be careful, that's the way you get sued." When interviewer Jenny Murray asked if she had ever had a sexual relationship, Widdecombe laughed and said, "It's nobody else's business." That's a femcel. I mean, I think she's probably low-key, like, you know, she might be into, you know? Or maybe she's just ace? Maybe. But if she was ace, she'd be happy. Because she's got no sex in her life. And I feel like she's too unhappy. I feel like there's, like, something, you know, that she's like, this woman was openly a virgin until 60. She's straight up just horny. That's why she's so evil. Wait, what? Really says something when the state has to be careful not to make prisoners better than the normal living conditions. I love Zoomers, man. Zoomers are so funny. I'll be looking at like a 80-year-old person who's like a virgin until they were 60. And I'm like, I'll say something along the lines of like, maybe she's a lesbian, like, but, you know, secretly or something. And like that kind of repressed attitude is like forcing her to be such a monster. And they're like, no, actually, you're wrong. She's probably a sapiosexual demi. It's like, okay, no, she's probably not that. Whatever you're pointing to, definitely not that. Okay, like that person, her brain will fry when you mention those things to that person. Okay, wait, Louis Thoreau followed her for a documentary. The uploader has not made this available in your country. Fucking poppycock.
And luxurious prison, but the evidence that it works is unclear. And if the Norwegian government remains unconvinced, the first of its kind might also be the last.
If this prison is so exceptional that it produces exceptional results, why doesn't your government, the Norwegian government, simply say, right, this is the future. All prisons from now on are going to be like Halden.
That's because this prison was quite expensive to build. We have new prisons in Norway now. That's not looking like this prison, but I think, as I told you, the most important thing is how the officers work with inmates, and that the inmates have activities, that they have workshops, that they have something to do all day. That's the most important thing.
You see, my worry is you've got this very expensive prison, which appears to work at this point.
Yeah, I think so. I think this work.
But outside, has it done anything that the other prisons haven't done? Yeah, that's the big question.
It's very clear that the small units, the workshops, and the officers' relationships with inmates are working. But what's less clear is whether this level of luxury is needed for rehabilitation.
Dude, oh my god, what a hilarious documentary, dude. There's something really funny about like doing an entire doc just to not learn the lesson, even if it's literally hitting you in the head with a hammer. I don't know why I love this. I really love this. It's like every documentary, there's a point and then there's an end, and you know, the narrator takes you on a journey where like they're learning and you're learning alongside the narrator. She's like, that. Like, I am not doing that, okay? I'm just straight up going to not learn the lessons. And I love that as a documentary concept. I want to watch her go to other situations. Like, I want to watch more. And Widdecombe does things like, conservatives have no media literacy, but in real life too. Wait, she was also on a reality TV show?
What I'm interested in is whether this approach seriously reduces the reoffending rates. And if that means a bit of luxury, then okay.
What I'm wondering, as I finally leave here, is whether I've spent the last 3 days looking at something which is very nice, but which is actually just a puff of theory, and a very, very expensive theory at that.
Wait.
Or whether I've actually been...
Wait, what? Bro, it's right there! You didn't read it in a book, you dumbass! You saw it in practice! Oh my god, dude! I'm losing my fucking mind right now. Okay, it's no longer funny. She's a psycho. Bro, it's no longer a theory if you're seeing it in practice.
I can't understand how you can do that. How you can say,
it's just a theory. A game theory. I'm Andrew Widdecombe. That's right. Norway. The country. Just a theory.
It's like, maybe it's not. Oh, what? Damn, bro. Didn't know you were showing up. Damn, looking good, dude. Looking spiffy.
Encountering a revolutionary way to treat criminals.
Okay. I need, like...
Well, no.
Oh, my God. Oh, what the... Oh, shield yourself, chat. Oh, she's casting a spell. She's casting a spell. Hey, if you like this video, please subscribe and hit that bell so you don't miss out on any future videos.